start playing a lot better when you give them the green light and you give them that trust and you say, hey, man, if you're balling out, I'm going to leave you out there for longer. They reward coaches. And Luke Walton was really bad, man. So you,
Luke Walton did a better job rewarding players than Frank Vogel's doing right now.
You see, now every single player that left Luke Walton's team really flourished and got better.
How many times have we seen Frank Vogel yank Kyle Kuzma? If Kyle Kuzma is hot, Frank Vogel is all going to take him out the game. Why is that? Don't know.
From D'Angelo to Julius to Jordan Clarkson to Thomas Bryant. I mean, the list goes on. So this is the reason I hated Luke Walton when he was on the Lakers. I love him as a person. He's a good guy. I love him as a player with the Lakers. He had a good basketball IQ, whatever. He was a good water boy. But, yeah, he's not a good coach. He holds young players back. And that's unfortunate. But, yeah, I mean, I'm very proud of the young core, the way they've developed, man. They really went on and became something special around the league. So that's only compliments to the front office and their drafting abilities, excellent drafting abilities. And I'm sure they'll continue to do that and getting gems in the second round and late first round. But back to tonight's game, where we went wrong, we were competing first quarter. I thought the defense was solid. It was 23-24. We were down 1 point. And, again, Frank Vogel did something I liked and something I hated. In the starting lineup, he started THT. Just the last post-game recap, we were in the comment section talking about, hey, you know, THT, you know, or Alex Caruso should start because, you know, they are a little more versatile on the offensive and defensive end. But then he goes and he takes out Kuz, who was balling in the starting lineup, for Markieff Morris. And I think that threw everything off. Our bench, again, inconsistent.
He basically did the same thing that Luke Walton did, is what take out players when they're cooking.
Lineups from your boy, Frank Vogel. And how can you expect consistency? Not making excuses by any means. Players dropped the ball tonight. But how can you expect consistency if you don't give consistency? I've been saying it all year long. Byron, a post-game, painful post-game recap as the Lakers fall to the Utah Jazz 114-89. Atrocious, man. We got exposed tonight at every angle due to the fact that we didn't play hard at all. But a lot of things wrong with this team right now. Currently, our confidence is in the toilet bowl. You can flush that right now. You can flush the confidence right now. We need to flush it and start for all over. I don't know where they forgot their championship team along the way, but injuries isn't an excuse. I understand that we had a very slim chance to win in this game, but I did expect competition. Man, Marc Gasol continues to get exploited off of pick and rolls. 3-point defense was trash, man. It was raining out there. They shot 45% from the beyond the arc, and we shot an abysmal 20.
That's absolute facts. Dan Laker fan is speaking absolutely facts. Our 3-point defense sucks.
4%, and we kept shooting.
Lakers are shooting 20-some percent from the three. Just imagine that. The Lakers team is shooting 20% from three.
That's the most frustrating part, man. That is the most frustrating part. Moves will be.
Can we beat Portland? I'm not sure. I'm not sure if we can beat Portland because our 3-point defense is so bad.
Made. I don't know how many or to what extent, but moves will be made. 24% from beyond the arc compared to their 45. The 3-point shooting struggles continue. They had 28 assists compared to our 17. They had 57 rebounds compared to our 52. They beat us in almost every category.
The loss of Dwight Howard and JaVale McGee is the reason why we're not winning the rebounding nor the defensive battle.
It was a ridiculous effort by this team. It was painful to watch.
That's absolute facts. No effort.
But I'm not going to be a pessimist because obviously we know the obvious. We're not even going to touch on the subject anymore. We're missing players, key crucial players. And I guarantee you, everybody that was clowning Anthony Davis for the poor start he was having when I was defending him, feels like a real clown right now because they see what we're missing. We ain't nothing without AD, straight up.
That's facts. Without AD, we ain't shit.
I'll say this, Dennis Schroeder as well makes a difference, and I think we get him back on Friday. So that's the good news. There's a silver lining in all this, man. that we're going to get Dennis back. And a lot of people believe there's going to be a big move being made. Now, here's the positive side of...
What's that move?
All this, man. Sometimes a front office can be a little bit delusional and think, oh, we'll be fine. It's just due to injuries.
I totally agree with that. Sometimes our GM does not make moves when it's needed. They tend to lay back and just say, oh, we're fine, when we're not.
And then you lose a game. And then, oh, it was the Brooklyn Nets. It's all right. You know, they're overpowered and we're missing players. We'll be fine. And then they lose another game. And it's like, oh, well, that one was closer. You know, we're competing at least. And they lose another game. It was close. We're competing. But then they lose another game. This time to the Utah Jazz. And we get blown out. We get dominated from end to end. Both sides need work. Now maybe Rob says, maybe we do need some more depth. Maybe we do need a minor trade here or there to tweak. Maybe, I'm not saying he should, you know, get trigger happy and start pulling off trades left and right. But maybe something to infuse some energy, because these guys look lifeless out there. I'll tell you that. And I was not happy with the effort. I told you guys I'd be okay with us losing, because obviously they're the better team right now due to the fact that they're healthy and we're not. But I needed to see effort, man. And this is not panic mode, but this is eye-opening a little bit. Like, whoa, we might be a little bit worse than I thought from the perimeter. We started off shooting lights out, and right now we can't hit anything to save our life, man. Strictly buckets. Appreciate you, bro. He said, I don't know why, but right now it feels like we won't even make the conference finals. But also, I feel like we will win the finals again. He said, what do you think? I'm getting nervous. We don't want to have any knee-jerk reactions. We don't want to be those fair-weather fans. Man, I saw a lot of fans on Twitter I had a trash, because they were talking about, oh, this franchise is cursed. That was like stupid stuff. Now, obviously, those aren't longtime Laker fans. We know what they are. You know, they're jock riders. They came over here all of a sudden following a said player or something. But bottom line is, look, it's not time to panic, but it is time to open your eyes of your Rob Pelinka and say, what else do we need besides a big man? Do we maybe need a better defensive wing? Do we need a more consistent three-point shooter? Like, what is going to happen? Because the effort is not there. And sometimes I'll say this once in a while when I don't see effort, especially from a defending championship team. Tonight's effort was not acceptable, no matter what. All right. And I'll say this once in a while. Maybe somebody needs to send a message and make a minor move. Maybe Wesley Matthews needs to dip. Maybe it's somebody else. I don't know. But
in my opinion, I believe we should trade Wesley Matthews. I do not like the way Wesley Matthews has been playing. As of late, he's been playing very bad basketball on both sides. I don't like Wesley Matthews nor Marcus Gasol.
Maybe there needs to be a little trade to get these, you know, boys' ears to perk up and be like, you know, we're not safe. All right, let's play our ass off again. You know, we're on a championship contending team. We need to start showing up. No excuses. I feel like the Lakers felt sorry for themselves ever since Anthony Davis went down. Remember?
That's facts. Whenever AD got hurt, the team fell apart.
That game when he got injured, we were competing. As soon as he goes down, boom, people stop playing. It's almost like they said, well, we can't do without him. And that is not the championship mindset. We continue to build on bad habits, and I'm not happy.
That's facts. We're building bad habits right now. We cannot be like the Clippers in the Nets. We have to build good habits on both sides of the ball. Right now, we're not showing the effort, and we're not building good habits.
About the effort tonight. This is not a rant, but I'm getting pretty close to fed up, man, and we need to make something happen. I'm talking addition without subtraction or minor tweak just to send a message. My man said, sub DTLF, man, we got destroyed. My boy said, but it's all good. It's still Lakers on mine, so the casket drops. Love it. That's the energy right there. He said, Jordan Clarkson. Yo, Jordan Clarkson killed us, but I'm not surprised. He's been balling all year long. Sixth man of the year, probably guaranteed if he continues to play like this. But I'm going to say this. I always knew he had talent. I always knew all these young cats had talent. That's the reason I really disliked Luke Walton, because he would put a leash on them. And every time they started going off, he would bench them, and he wouldn't let them go and give them the green light. These players really...
That's the one thing I disagree with this guy on. Luke Walton actually called plays for guys like Brandon Ingram. If you watch, even when LeBron got to L.A., Luke Walton was still calling plays for Brandon Ingram, Kyle Kuzma, Lonzo Ball. You know, this coach, Frank Vogel is not a play caller. Luke Walton actually calls play.